Hey everybody, welcome to Pop Culture Philosophers. I'm Rockin Robbie Billups. It's time for the weekly comic book review. That's right, everybody. Time for the weekly comic book review. It's the show where I read a lot of comic books and I let you know what I thought about them. And we always start with the pick of the week, and this week's pick of the week comes from Valiant Comics. It's Quantum and Woody. Number two, Quantum and Woody, back in the day in the 90s, Christopher Priest, M.D. Bright. It was a fantastic run, a great comic book. I loved it then. I loved the recent relaunch of Valiant that they did a few couple years ago, and I fell out of that, and I don't really know what's been happening, but I picked this one up, first of all, straight up because of the foil covers, using that vintage 90s foil covers and chromium, stuff that's left over from the 90s days. I think the concept's just neat and kind of cool and gimmicky, and I just love it. And the foil on the cover is super, super clean and awesome, and I just love it. Worth it alone for that, but this book seriously shines bright. In fact, it definitely pays tribute and respect to what Priest and Bright did before, and it just keeps it in tone. It's a fun, action-y, just a great experience to read this comic book. The artwork is done by Kano, and it is just beautiful. Really innovative ways to tell the story. Some really cool coloring. Really fantastically bright coloring. Perfectly done by Kano. So seriously, he does all of the artwork himself. Great panel design, great composition, great flow, great just fantastic ways of telling the story. This page right here that you got to spin around. It is so good. It's written by Eric Henderson. No, it's not. Eric Henderson's a character in the book. That's Quantum. Daniel Kibblesmith is the writer. Kibblesmith, Kano, you guys are doing a fantastic job on this book. Seriously, gimmicky covers aside, which are awesome, the book inside is even better. It is fantastic. It is fast. It's fun. It's funny. It's humorous. It's got heart to it. It's got crisp dialogue. It moves at a very brisk pace, but it just feels so fulfilling, especially with the art and how it's handled and the way that the story is told. This book is levels beyond. Check it out this week in your shop if you get a chance, and even if you miss the foil cover, seriously pick up this book. It is that good. Pick of the week, Quantum and Woody, number two. Kudos to Valiant right there. Let's move over to DC Comics. It's DC Comics. It is a fifth Wednesday, but there's still a lot of stuff out there, so do not miss out. Some big stuff, including Metal number five. Speaking of cool metal foil covers, right? Metal number five is finally here. There's not going to be a Metal number six next month in February. It's going to be the Wild Hunt one-shot, and then number six will be arriving in March. But Metal number five, the penultimate issue of the main six-issue series, was a blast. It's fun, it's loud, it's absurd, it's crazy. The stakes are getting higher and higher and higher. The situation is appearing more hopeless. How are the heroes going to get out of it? Really, just everything is crushing all hope and good in the DC Universe in the pages of Metal right now, and it couldn't be better. This stuff is amazing. Scott Snyder and Greg Capullo are doing some of the work of their careers, fan favorites. Really, really fun, hype, giant, high-octane energy. It's a blast. Metal has been so fun. Greg Capullo's artwork is great. The demons and the demonic Batman and the Batman who laughs, it all looks crazy. Beautiful colors from FCO Placencia. Great lettering by Jonathan Clapione. Just really, really cool stuff. Lots of different elements going on, all coming together, all coming to an head, promising quite a big finish. And once again, some returning characters. Really big. It's a real fun hoot. You got to check it out. Seriously, Metal has not been disappointing. Also from DC Comics, we have Silencer number one, part of the new age of heroes. Damage number one, I was really sold on. I've actually had a chance to read issue two, and it's great as well. So how does Silencer fare? This one is done by John Romita Jr. and Dan Abnett. I thought this was really, really cool. It was actually really fun. It's not going to be the cleanest Romita Jr. artwork, but it is nice. It's not quite like what he was doing. Like his work on All-Star Batman was just like some of the peak of his career, but it's good. The coloring is solid. It's a very intriguing story with a new character. It's got a lot of action into it. I like it. I did like it a lot. I'm going to try to show you a page. It doesn't spoil too much for you, but some pretty cool action scenes. Romita has been a master storyteller ever since he first came on the comic book artist scene, and Dan Abnett does a great job with the script. introducing a new character, new concepts, filling you in. It's got an appearance by Talia al Ghul, so that's kind of cool connection to the outside DC universe. But so far, two issues in, talking about Damage and Silencer. This New Age of Heroes is pretty solid, pretty good stuff, worth you checking out. Silencer was actually a really good book. I really enjoyed it. We now have, from DC Young Animal and DC, a kind of a crossover. Justice League of America meets the Doom Patrol in the Milk Wars. And just in typical Young Animal fashion, we got this crazy promo. It's a milk carton. My buddy Billy hooked me up with that, so I want to thank you for that. Seriously, got milk. It's good stuff. Anyway, Justice League Doom Patrol was interesting. It does spin directly kind of out of recent events of Doom Patrol. Gerard Way's been doing a hell of a job there. I have not been reading Steve Orlando's Justice League of America. This is Steve Orlando and Gerard Way. You can definitely tell that it's more Steve Orlando. The story is all right. The story concept is really neat and it's really cool and kind of clever, and I really like what it is. The execution and the dialogue and the flow of the story, though, was a little jilted and confusing. But that's kind of like the method of Doom Patrol, right? Seriously. But Aiko, the artist, fantastic stuff. Just like with Kano over on Quantum and Woody, brilliant methods to like tell the story, great layouts, beautiful, beautiful coloring by Tamara Bonvillain and Marissa Luisa. We know Bonvillain from Doom Patrol. So it does fit that weird zany Doom Patrol style. There's this crazy like Pleasantville type world where some of the Justice League of America have been remade, and it's because of this milk, and it is tied into what's going on kind of in Doom Patrol, so I would advise Doom Patrol fans to check it out. But if you're just your typical DC fan, I don't know how you're going to feel about this, because it's weird, it's wild, it's zany, and it's crazy, and that's what Young Animal is supposed to be. Young Animal is going to be relaunching very, very soon this year. All their titles are getting like renumbered, renamed a little bit, actually, some new concepts, some new directions, so that's exciting. Also, we got Eternity Girl coming out. But seriously, Doom Patrol has been a highlight of DC Comics over the last year, and this Milk Wars story is not going to quite sell you on the concept of Doom Patrol, but it is a fun little read that I found engaging with really, really gorgeous artwork, really good stuff. Also, we got Flash Annual number 1 from DC Comics. This is the start, it's the prelude of the big Flash War story coming up. Joshua Williamson, his Flash run has been pretty solid. It has its ups, it has its down. Right now, the Flash book is on a big up. This issue right here spotlights Wally West. If you haven't been reading Titans, you don't really know what's been going on with Wally West. Apparently not much. He hasn't really progressed forward with his life. He's the man out of time. He doesn't have a place here in this universe. Nobody remembers him. This is about him kind of dealing with that, and it's going to lead into something future-wise. Also, the murder of the Reverse Flash by Iris West starts getting investigated, and there's some neat revelations that spin out of that that are going to lead into the Flash War. What is the Flash War? We don't quite know, but there's a lot of temporal stuff going on, time shifting, things changing, history shifting. So definitely, if you're trying to pay attention to the whatnots of the timeline, the DC Universe, say the Hyper Time, the DC Rebirth, Watchmen stuff, all that jazz, you might want to pick this one up because it does touch on that Wally West bit. The art is kind of all over the place. You got Christian Duce and you got Howard Porter on it, so it's kind of inconsistent back and forth. But fans of old school Wally West stories, you're really going to like this book and appreciate some of the references. And when you see the bit of the Flash Museum in the future, Flash fans, pay attention, look around. There's some little Easter eggs in there to see. That's kind of cool. Another annual from DC Comics, the Detective Comics Annual number 1. This book was awesome. It represents the origin of Clayface. Lots of stuff happening in Detective Comics right now with Clayface. This kind of is a nice coda. It's just a nice little bridge into the moment before the big final act of this, what's going on right now. James Tynion IV has been doing a hellaciously awesome job on Detective Comics. Get Eddie Barrows doing the artwork on here, who was doing the artwork on that when Rebirth first started. Amazing, beautiful artwork. A really cool, touching tale about Clayface. His origin, kind of from the animated series, like that really good version of it, but a little bit updated. Some different things happening. Great, brilliant artwork. Everything works so well. The faces, the acting in the faces, that's kind of appropriate for a Clayface origin story. But it's horrendous when it needs to be. It's subtle and touching when it needs to be. And it's tragic and horrifying when it needs to be. And it needs to be all those things almost every single page. And they do such a great job with this. Seriously. Clayface fans, check it out. Bat fans, check it out. That's some really good comic books right there. From Marvel Comics, we have the final issue of Phoenix Resurrection Number five, The Return of Jean Grey. And this series is just the worst, man. I just do not like this series whatsoever. It felt so out of place, so shoehorned in. Matthew Rosenberg is a talented, talented writer. This is not going to be the book to prove that to you. This feels kind of like editorially mandated Marvel Legacy. Let's bring back Jean. What can we do to correct and right the ship with the X-Men? Maybe we bring back Jean. I am excited for this X-Men Red book coming out next week, I believe. But this didn't do anything for me. It was kind of confusing. It was kind of dull. It had some moments that should have been touching, but it had some really inconsistent art throughout the entire series. Overall, I cannot recommend this book. Hardcore Jean Grey fans, you're going to want to know what's going on, but I've read this whole thing. It was the worst, man. I just did not like that. Avengers 678 brings us the fourth part of No Surrender. Avengers is now weekly. Mark Waid, Al Ewing, and Jim Zub doing it now, kind of combining those three Avengers books that existed, Uncanny, U.S. Avengers, and regular Avengers, all into one book, and a big epic story that's finally worthy of the Avengers, and it's fun, and it deals with a lot of the characters, and it balances them around. It's really, really cool. Plus, you got this mystery of who is Valerie Vector, a.k.a. Voyager, so that's really intriguing. This issue really kind of spotlights the Human Torch, of course, me being a huge Fantastic Four fan. I really liked that. So I do like this story. It's fun. It's big. It's epic. It's got lots of action, lots of high stakes. Ultimately, though, it's not really feeling like, say, Metal feels like it's so dire and so important and crucial that DC makes it through it. This doesn't feel like that. Maybe it should. Maybe it shouldn't. I don't know. But you got the Black Order in here. You got the Lethal Legion. That's all cool. That's cool and neat and everything. But it's not that level, but it is a fun little Avengers story. The Avengers books have been really kind of weak in the last few years for me, ever since Hickman left, but this stuff is kind of like steering it back into the direction I think it should be in. Classic fans, new fans, is something for everybody as long as you're an Avengers fan. So we're building up to the Infinity War. Let's see what happens there. Iron Man, Invincible he is, 596, continues this neat little blending of the previous Invincible Iron Man title and the infamous Iron Man. So you got the Riri Williams story, you got the Victor Von Doom story, and you got the Tony Stark story. Where is Tony Stark? What's going up with him? What's in his head? So that's all what's in here. The Riri stuff is really awesome. The Victor Von Doom stuff is beyond awesome. It is great. The hood's in it. Some really great artwork from Alex Maleev. Just Doom may be trying to be a hero, but he is still Victor Von damn Doom, you know what I'm saying? And then at the end here, you got some neat little stuff with Tony Stark and the mystery, and Tony has officially been confirmed as coming back as Iron Man in 599, so we got some time to go. Bendis has only a few issues left here. He says issue 800, 600 is like kind of like, 600 is going to be his last Marvel comic. He says it's kind of like his final thesis on what he does, what he's been doing at Marvel, so that's kind of cool. Speaking of Bendis and Marvel, this is his second to last issue of The Defenders, and this has been his best work in Marvel in years to me. I love this book. David Marquez doing the artwork does not hurt at all. Artwork is a little rushed in this one. Maybe there were some time issues with Bendis, probably some delay or something when Bendis was in the hospital. Glad he's feeling a lot better. Excited to see what he's doing at DC. But sad to see him leaving this book, The Defenders. This book has been fun, and it is actually ending, I think, at issue 10. I don't think they have plans to bring it back right now. Maybe they will in some other iteration coming up soon. But this book has been fun. This Kingpin story, like who's going to be the new Kingpin of New York? You got Diamondback, you got Black Cat, you got the Hood. Lots of different things going on. It's really fun. The dynamic between the characters, Jessica, Luke, Danny, Matt, it's perfect. It's great. Bendis totally has nailed the voice of these street-level Marvel characters. The coloring by Justin Ponser is amazing and just illuminating. I love the coloring in this book. I love the story. And seriously, Bendis did it. 17-year-long running gag. Bendis, that was awesome. Great issue. Very sad to see that one wrapping up. Old Man Logan, number 34, is here. And no artwork from Mike Diodato Jr., who had been putting in the artwork of his career on this title in the last few issues. I'm not even kidding. Stuff is going like he's evolving his style, and it's so good. It's textured. It's great. He did the cover. He did not do the interior artwork, but the interior artwork, while it may not seem to be as complex and well thought out as, say, the Diodato stuff, Ibrahim Robertson does a great job on here. Really good detail. Does a great job. It lets me know that it's not just Diodato's art that was selling this book. Ed Brisson's script is really, really solid as well. He knows how to tell a Wolverine tale. He knows how to tell a Wolverine story exceptionally well. Wolverine stories don't need to be too much. They need to have a little bit of drama and a lot of action, a lot of just grumbling and getting shot up. And that's what happens in this book. And it's fun, and it harkens back to some stuff that old school Wolverine fans are really going to like. But seriously, Ed Brisson's doing a great job in here. The artwork is really solid in here, too. And Diodato's moving on to bigger and better things, I believe. But this book is in good hands. The artwork is good still. The story is great. Old Man Logan's been really, really good. Also from Marvel, you got Tales of Suspense 101. The second part of Red Ledger, this is like a 5-issue series, by Matthew Rosenberg. A much better showcasing of his art, of his writing talents in Tales of Suspense as opposed to Phoenix Resurrection. I'm not trying to hate on that book, but I just did not enjoy that one whatsoever. Tales of Suspense I like a little bit better. Travel Foreman, not usually the biggest fan of his artwork, but I do think it works here. Some spacious backgrounds, a lot of empty space that I feel like kind of takes away from the flow of the art, you know, in the story. But it's intriguing and it's neat, and Bucky and Hawkeye kind of being together, it's this buddy cop thing, and it's kind of like the Odd Couple type thing, so that's kind of fun. Someone's killing Hydra agents. They think it's Black Widow, or Hawkeye thinks it's Black Widow. They're trying to figure out who it is and why. And there's a big mystery involved and a neat little cliffhanger ending. So that book's been all right. It's been all right. But it deserves to be a miniseries, probably. But I don't know. Star Wars DJ Most Wanted. This is about Benicio Del Toro's character from The Last Jedi. I loved The Last Jedi. I loved Benicio in that movie. So I was really pumped to read this book, and I did not like it. I did not like it at all. The coolest thing about this book is that it's written by these two guys, Ben Acker and Ben Blacker. That's perfect. Is that fake? Are those names made up? That's the best thing about this book. The art is actually pretty decent. Kev Walker does it. I didn't really like it. I guess it's like the story of what DJ was up to before they find him on that planet in Last Jedi, which is probably the weakest part of the film, but I do like Benicio Del Toro in almost everything he does, because he can't just do anything straight. He's got to add his own little thing to it, and it's just not present in this book. I think it's something in his performance that I found charming, but not in the book. The book was kind of all over the place. Didn't really like it at all. From Vault Comics, we have Maxwell's Demon number 2. Issue number 1 was great. It just blew me away. I thought it was fantastic. Issue number 2, at first I was really confused. I was like, I don't know how this is connected to issue 1 or whatever, but this book was awesome. This book had so many just wild, crazy ideas per page, sometimes per panel. Things that any other writer would take and make an entire story out of. Denise Camp, who is the writer, just uses them as just caption boxes and all these crazy concepts and ideas with glorious artwork by Victorio Astoni. This is really, really solid, and it sold me on checking out more of Vault Comics stuff. But this book is amazing. First of all, you got that great wraparound cover. Look at the art there. The art, the coloring, everything is so cool. And like I said, these crazy sci-fi concepts, crazy metaphysical concepts. Look at that artwork. It's gorgeous. And this is a really cool tale. It feels like it was meant to be like a one-and-done type story connected to an overall thing. So it's really intriguing, slightly confusing, but not in a bad way, in a way that like has hooked me into knowing what exactly Camp's got up his sleeve. This book is awesome. This thing is amazing. Seriously, if you're fans of like the crazier writers, like you're like Warren Ellis, you like Grant Morrison, you like Gerard Way, you like that type of stuff, check this out. Camp is an up-and-coming writer that has a very, very bright future if this issue is anything to say to it. Seriously, expertly paced, brilliantly and beautifully rendered, and like just great, crazy ideas just flowing from, just oozing off the pages. Just so much high concept awesomeness in this book. It was fantastic. Absolutely, check out Maxwell's Demons. That is something you do not want to miss. From Dark Horse Comics and Berger Books. So yeah, is it Karen, right? Karen Berger? Yeah, Karen Berger or Berger. I don't know how to say that correctly. But anyway, she was the biggest deal at Vertigo back in the day. So Dark Horse has given her own imprint to see what she can do. Get Anthony Bourdain. Yes, that's right. From, you know, the Food Network and the travel shows and all that stuff. So that's really cool. It's kind of like this like ghost story anthology involving food. But I just didn't really like it. Some of the art was okay. The artwork is by, like, seriously, you got Vanessa Del Rey, and you got Alberto Ponticelli, who did that Frankenstein Agent of Shade book, which I really, really like. And it's Anthony Bourdain and Joel Rose, who is his writing partner. And there's some neat little ideas in here, some nice little fun stories. But it just didn't really do that much for me. Eternity number 4 arrives from Valiant Comics. It's the final issue of Eternity, which is the 4th book of the whole Divinity saga. I've read Divinity Book 1 now and loved it. Haven't read 2 or 3. I jumped right in here, though, first, because it was just crazy and just cosmic and cool. And even though I'm still just a little kind of out of the flow of the whole story, this was very satisfying. This has gotten me hooked. I want to read all of this now because Matt Ken and Trevor Harrison are doing a fantastic job. Brilliant, beautiful artwork highlighted by these rich, rich colors that are just fantastic. Absolutely. The colors are by David Barron, but the artwork is solid. The writing is so crazy and just out there, and it's nutty, and I love stuff that's crazy and out there and nutty, if you haven't realized it. But Eternity wrapped up a beautiful story and left more to come, so I'm excited about this whole Divinity saga. From Aftershock Comics, who, seriously, did we all sleep on Aftershock Comics? Because I sure did. They are doing some solid, solid work right now. Dark Arc is one of those books. Issue number 5 is out this week from Cullen Bunn and artist Wando. The art is great. I love the artwork, especially the colors. So bright, luminescent. These angels show up to visit this evil Dark Arc, and just look how it just shines off the page. It's so striking. And everything about this book I really, really like, except for, I don't want to talk about it. We'll talk about it next time. I don't want to spoil anything, but Dark Arc is awesome. It's a story basically about the other arc. There was Noah's Ark, then there was the evil arc with all the vampires and werewolves and creatures of the night and monsters and all that kind of foul stuff, right? This is Satan's arc. It's a fun story. It's intriguing. This is the end of the first arc. It's coming back in May, so there will be a trade out soon, or now you can go back and try to get issues 1 through 5 and read them all, because this stuff is awesome. Dark Arc is wicked fun on the high waters. That's bad. I shouldn't have said that. Bonehead number 2 arrives from Top Cow Comics. We got Bonehead number 2 from Top Cow and Image Comics. I really was impressed with issue 1 of Bonehead, and I am just as impressed with issue number 2. Seriously, created by Machine 56. I don't know what all this glitch stuff is. I need to internet this and find some stuff out. Written by Brian Edward Hill with artwork by Roland Marcellius. This is awesome. It's like these crazy, it's like this sci-fi future tech type world. These people wear these masks that like hook them up into this like, I don't know, this like virtual reality type thing or something. It's like augmented reality to them, and there are these parkour gangs going around. Brilliant costume design. There's this dude in here named Pumpkin Juice who's got the sweetest new costume I've seen in a comic book in forever. Look at that dude right there. That is a pimp costume. I love it. The costume and the designs are great. The energy, it flows the way they tell the story. It's high octane. It's got great, brisk dialogue, great script that runs all the way through that I just highly, highly enjoy. These other glitch books, God Complex, it's all right. Dissonance was okay, but Bonehead is pretty solid. I really like this. And they're parkour and they're flying all over the city and jumping on drones and all kinds of crazy cool sci-fi action type stuff. So that's what I read this week, and that's what I thought about it. Seriously, guys, Bonehead is solid. Don't sleep on Maxwell's Demons. That book is amazing. Metal is fun as always. Give Silencer a shot. It's awesome. But seriously, check out Quantum and Woody. That is just some really brilliant, beautiful stuff. Let me know what you read and what you thought about it in the comments down below. Please do like, share, and subscribe, and check us out at popculturephilosophers.com, where we have our podcast, and some of the podcast episodes are here on YouTube. Please do check out that podcast. We enjoy doing it. We got a Nintendo one coming out very, very soon, like within days. So be on the lookout for that. Thank you guys for rocking with us, and keep on reading.